Now moving on, we will start the conference with a very robust panel discussion. And the topic for this panel discussion is what brand advocacy looks like generating passion. Ladies and gentlemen, the session chair for this panel discussion is Mr. Ashwin Padmanabhan. He is head trading and partnership Group M. Ashwin, as I have said, heads trading and partnerships for Group M in India. His key mandate is to work with media, content, data and technology partners to co-create unique and innovative media solutions that will enhance the value that Group M agencies offer to their clients. Ladies and gentlemen, I would now request Mr. Ashwin to please come and join me on the stage and to take this session forward.
Thank you. I think without much ado, I'd like to invite my co-panelists, Anupam, the CMO of Sanjiv Goenka Group FMCG business. We've seen a couple of brands from this table, one brand in specific which has made some waves in the recent past, Too Yum, and a unique positioning that they've taken. So Anupam, glad to have you here. Anurita. A very tough category you manage, Anurita. So Anurita heads the oral health category at GSK, and we all have heard of the brand Sensodyne. Very tough one to manage, so we'll talk more about that. Mayank, category head at Parle, an iconic brand with multiple iconic sub-brands within. I was just talking about the fact that our panel, probably except for Sandeep here, is so FMCG heavy, so we're going to have some interesting conversations. Puneet. Puneet is the head of marketing at Tata Global Beverages. We've seen some fantastic campaigns coming from here, including the Tata Tea Jagore 2, which made some big waves. Sudhanshu. He's the category head Biscuits at Mondelez. How can we not know about Oreo and the kind of penetration it's managed to make so quickly? 2011 is, I think, when Oreo came into India. Yeah, so in 6-7 years, Oreo is all over the place. Soumya. Soumya is the chief client officer at Kantar IMRB. And finally, Sandeep. Sandeep is the head of marketing at Jaquar. An example of a company which is diversified across different product categories. And I think the biggest new launch that they did was in the lighting business. We were just talking how well it's done for them. So thank you all. Thank you for making time today. We guys were talking about today's conversation and maybe I kind of threw a question which got everybody rallied against me. but it's an interesting conversation that do we really need advocates? Do brands really need advocates? But we'll talk more about that. But before we start, I think there is something that I read about a couple of years back, a book which kind of changed the way I look at the world. And this is not a marketing book, a book called The Sapiens by Mr. Harari. And he spoke about this concept called imagined realities and how Peugeot was the first company that got created ever in the world. And what was it? It was like a real person, but it's an imagined reality. There's no physical manifestation to that, but it was an imagined reality. And he speaks about how when the Homo sapiens became the predominant human species 40,000 years ago, what differentiated them from the other human species that existed then was the ability of the Homo sapiens to create stories, to bind people together with stories, find common ground, stories like imagined realities like a country, imagined realities like a football team, bring them together and rally people around to a cause or rally people around to buying something. What brands, I think the first brand happened, what, 80 years back, 80, 90 years back? And I think brands are an example of an imagined reality, but we don't think of it like that because it's a part of our daily lives today. And brands get adopted by each of us. We all are consumers, it gets adopted. Some of us have our preferred brands, but we tend to switch as well. But we do talk about some brands with great pride whenever we meet anybody, whenever we talk to someone. And that's what all of us dream of, right? To have more and more consumers talk about our brands and become advocates for our brands. But what's the trigger for some consumers to become advocates? And I think that's what I'm curious about. All of you have spent many, many years working with mass market brands, and I'm sure you would have had experiences where something clicked, something worked, which connected the brand with the consumer. And what is that formula? I think that's a question that probably if you can unravel, it might, you know, even for the audience, it might be quite helpful. So, over to you.
Hi, good evening all. I think it's an important question, and I think perhaps a key question that sets the ball rolling in what defines brand advocacy or consumer advocacy for that matter. And I think that could be several things, but I think as a primary, whatever the brand promises, if it delivers that commitment to the consumer, it's a good start. So whether it is the brand's proposition, whether it's the functional promise, whether it's the emotional promise, and the experience that the brand delivers to the consumer, I think it starts with that. Many a times it happens that we falter at the very first step, and that's where the engagement starts to break, and there is no seeds sown of the engagement to start. So I think that perhaps is one start. And actually, ensuring that you continue doing it time and again and keep the customer or the consumer happy and satisfied actually is really the core where brand advocacy starts. So I think over a period of time, if you feel that you know you have given what you promised and the consumer has appreciated it, there is a bit of loyalty that starts to form, and that's where some seeds of brand advocacy starts to actually get germinated.
So I think a very important point, very basic point, if you deliver what you promise, advocacy starts from there. I think beautifully said. Anurita, you manage, like I said, an extremely tough category. Is it a oral health category? It's somewhere in between what a doctor prescribes to what, as a consumer, I would probably tend to use as a product every day, right? In fact, a lot of the communication, Sensodyne especially, tends to lean on specialists like doctors to talk about the efficacy. How do you build consumer advocates for a category like this?
Thanks for the question, Ashwin. To me, and I'll answer the question in two ways. The only thing that matters is the moment of truth. And that moment of truth can happen when you first get introduced to a brand. And I'm going back to when we all, you know, started understanding what brands were. And the first thing that we were taught or learned was that a brand is a human being. Yeah, a brand has a persona, a brand has a connection. So the only thing that matters is the emotional connect that the brand has with its consumers. And I will recall, you know, even as a kid, the Mozart's tune of Titan. Those are the things that, you know, it evokes something in you, and people actually buy, you know, products based on this emotional response. Now, coming to your question on oral health, yes, it's a very, very tough category to move, half a millimeter takes a lot of effort. And especially with Sensodyne, as you rightly said, that it is a specialist brand. But the good news, or the bad news, whichever way you put it, the good news for us is 1 in 3 people suffer from sensitivity. And people don't know that. So our first task is to educate consumers, to make them understand that it is a problem, it will not go away, it will worsen over time. But for them, the moment of truth is again how they connect with it, the usage of the product, to your point that it has to finally deliver its purpose. So it gives you relief, it makes you sensitivity free, lets you enjoy that ice lolly, that garam chai, that thanda pani, things that you're living without for no reason. So that's the purpose of this brand, and that's what we are living up to.
So again, kind of taking on from what Anupam said about you promise something and you deliver, you have a very functional benefit for the brand, but your challenge is getting people to become aware that, hey, this is a problem in your lives and you need to figure out something about it. But have you used advocates in your communication who are consumer advocates?
Our first advocate is the dentist. So we use the dentist, and those are actual practicing dentists. In the UK, we cannot use the Indian dentist, and I hear so much about this, but it's the Indian laws, and we cannot use Indian dentists, much as I would like to. But we reach 20,000 dentists.
So you use a foreign dentist who's an Indian.
Absolutely. But we reach 20,000 dentists, and they believe in the product. They believe in the science behind the product. And we have consumers. For us, it's phenomenal the kind of word of mouth we get from consumers talking to each other, telling each other that it works. And we do a lot of social listening, we do a lot of course, direct consumer interaction, and it's fascinating because you have people telling each other, go use Sensodyne because it will change your life. So while the promise is rational, but the benefit that it has to changing your life is very, very emotional. I mean, talk to a person who goes through an electric shock every time he has an ice cream, he or she will tell you.
Absolutely. So translating what you promise functionally, what we're saying is ultimately connects with consumers at an emotional and at much deeper level, and that's where the relationship starts getting built. So I'll jump to Sudhanshu there. You know, you manage like an iconic brand, right? And a brand which probably all of us have tried to play with. I think you use the word play quite often in your communication.
Absolutely. Right? Well said.
So probably advocacy has not been a challenge because consumers have been living with the brand and with the product in different ways. They talk about it. Probably they don't even talk about it. They just use it in different ways. How did Oreo get here? I know it's a long journey for Oreo, but it's one unique brand probably worldwide, which has managed to take this position, which has managed to connect with consumers so deeply and in so many different ways.
So I think I resonate with what Anurita and Anupam has just said. I think, and I also connect with what Sir said, it really boiled down, how do you create brand love? How do you create passion for brand? It boils down to what experience you are giving to consumer. And I mean, the way we think about it and the way Oreo globally has been thought through, experience is not just the product promise, but what does the larger purpose, the brand stands for, and what is the larger role which brand wants to serve in consumer's life. And it's very important, if you want to become an iconic brand, you need to get what we call, product to purpose, brand foundation right. So what's your product promise? What's your emotional payoff? And what's your larger purpose? So in case of Oreo, if you see, this brand is really all about building moments of bonding between kids and father and siblings. And that's something which really is a delight, which resonates with moms across the globe a lot. So a product ritual, which is twist lick dunk, which is a product promise, triggering that moment of connection, a moment of playful connection between a kid and a father, which is just a delight for a mom. So that's, that's something this brand stands for. It's rooted in very, very strong consumer-centric insight, which is a tension which, creates aha. And when you have that kind of a brand foundation and you be consistent, and then you, over the years, through your creative excellence, build that proposition in consumer mind and deliver that experience, which creates that aha. I think that's that's at the heart of it. How do you create brand love? You know, your product promise and your purpose needs to be solid and resonate with consumer, and you need to be consistent.
But I guess we all try to achieve this with all
Absolutely.
Our brands. But what Oreo has achieved is probably beyond many other brands have been able to do. Is it just happened or is there a design?
So I think this is the holy grail of marketing. There are brands which have been able to achieve that kind of an iconic stature. There are brands which are not. I think it's all boiled down to saying, again, what is it you need to, as a brand marketeer, try and build that purpose, what your brand stands for, rooted in consumer understanding. The stronger your consumer understanding is, stronger the cultural tension you understand, and hence try and play a role, and then be consistent. So I think the answer is, as far as brand love is concerned, I'll take few names. Oreo is a great example. Cadbury Dairy Milk is another example. I mean, it's a brand which defines the golden taste of chocolate in this country. But it's not just the product. It stands for something which is much bigger than just a chocolate. It's about amplifying that moment of joy in your life, which everyone seeks. And it's something which, in our campaigns like Kuch Meetha Ho Jai, over the years, we have been doing consistently and in an excellent manner. And that's what make brands. I think great example, I'm sure Mayank can talk about, Parle Ji. It's a simple, great product, but it's not just the product. It stands for some philosophy. Similarly, brands like Bonvita, it's at the end of the day, a nutritional, tasty milk additive, but it stands for certain philosophy. So I think that's the holy grail of marketing. How do you, really, get to the right foundation, which is your right product promise to right purpose, and then be consistent and do some excellent creative work over the years, is what makes brand. I think the other piece which I just want to talk about, creating brand love in today's world is not just enough. Not every consumer who loves your brand will be your advocate. So how do you trigger this loyal consumer or a consumer who loves you to come out of its lethargy or inertia and talk about it? And that's the new space which I think as a marketeer we are trying to test and learn. How do you entice, how do you encourage, or maybe how do you even reward your loyal customers to come out, engage, interact, and spread the word? So in that space, there's a lot of stuff which we are trying. So Oreo, for example, I was talking with you, the whole piece around creating recipes. Now, we know it's something which, it's great interest. It's something which is very meaningful for the consumer out there. And when you create recipes, when you put it out there, when you create some kind of engagement around it, consumer engages, share, and it becomes larger than life. I mean, it gets you a lot wider reach than probably you were otherwise planning for. I mean, it improves your marketing ROI, like how? And it spreads the word, it spreads the, further strengthens the love for the brand. So there's this whole piece around saying, as a marketeer, you need to build love for your brand, but at the same time, you need to start learning on how do you entice, encourage, and reward these consumers to come out and spread the word for you. So I see these are two different spaces, and both are challenging, but yeah, that's where.
So you use the word loyalty, and we all know of Mr. Byron Sharp's view on loyalty. So we'll talk about that. But Puneet, you've got a product which is a staple. And we probably use this product almost robotically when we start our day, right? And but over the years, Tata Tea has managed to carve a very clear image which you've kind of given it different versions as you've gone by, you've evolved it, and you came up with Jagore 2 last year, right? And it did significantly well. You took two big causes to take to the market. How have you seen campaigns like Jagore and the way you've evolved the campaign as well over the years link back to consumers associating with the brand and feeling good about being associated with the brand as well? What kind of, finally, when you look at business, how has it impacted you?
Yeah, so I think just picking up on some of the points that the panel here was making, you know, it is about driving an emotional connection. That's what, you know, brand advocacy, one of the pillars for success is. In some of the products, you know, I mean, you mentioned correctly, it's tea at the end of the day. You know, you wake up and you have tea. How do you, so the moment of truth has been met, you know, the functional aspect has been met. So it's a very transactional relationship, right? That stage is not going to get you the brand advocacy. That's going to get you at best a loyal customer or a satisfied customer, and which is where I agree that satisfaction and loyalty is not enough. If you really want consumers to talk about your brand, there needs to be a sense of ownership. And that sense of ownership comes in our case, Jaquar was about standing for causes which consumers identify with. Because they need to feel they're the part of the brand. I mean, and advocacy is a very, very strong word.
You think consumers' passions and what the brand stood for came together?
So one of the hallmarks of success is that, you know, it was not a marketing out campaign. It was about going through what the pulse of the nation is, what's the mood of the country right now. I mean, at that various points in time, what are they feeling, whether it was at the corruption stage, inspiring people to vote more, or in the last campaign, which is about don't just wait for things to happen, but pre-act. It was about sensing what the mood of the country or the larger audience is, and then, you know, showcasing them and asking them to be a part of it. In fact, the success of Jaquar has been that it's been a two-way relationship. So which is the other point that I was trying to, that brand advocacy, you were asking for a formula, you know. Everyone's talked about experience. I think the other missing factor is relationship. What sort of relationship are you having with your consumer? Is it a transactional one-way relationship or is it a two-way? Because if only you get to that stage is when the ownership starts coming and the brand passion starts coming and consumers talk about your brand. So in our case, it has been brand advocacy based on a purpose which people and the larger population resonate with, and we have sort of managed to keep it contemporized because it's built on genuine sort of an emotion.
And you've seen a positive impact of the way Tata Tea has taken Jaquar as a primary vehicle in terms of the way you've been able to create advocates for the brand, as well as finally when I look at sales numbers.
Yeah.
You've seen significant...
Oh, yeah, absolutely. That's the reason why, obviously, we have also continued with for over 10 years and, you know, one of the first brands to probably would have started in the FMCG space and continued with it. And it's got Tata Tea Premium is the number one brand. So it has worked for us from a business point of view. But more importantly, as Mr. Anurag was also mentioning in the beginning, it's based on a very authentic experience. And I think that has resonated well with the consumers and ensured that, you know, so we, even in the brand team, you know, the brand teams that work on it, the kind of passion and the kind of purpose that they, you know, you can see on their faces, it's much more than any other marketing campaign, because I think it resonates and it's taken a tea, which, you know, you wake up to almost to a place where, you know, it awakens me, you know, and taking it to that level. Yeah. So, from a business point of view and from a emotion point of view, I think both it resonates very well.
Cool. Sandeep, obviously, when I first saw Jaguar's lighting commercial, I was a bit taken aback because in my mind, Jaguar was so deeply embedded into the space of bathroom fittings and similar kind of products. And it took me some time to kind of relate Jaguar to a new category like that. The brand's the same, a new product category. How have you been able to translate the kind of advocates you've had for the traditional categories Jaguar has been in to the new category of lighting that you've brought on? Have you seen some kind of transfer happening of advocates of the brand Jaguar, even though the product category has changed? Because it's a different kind of a switch you're trying to do.
Lighting is just a new business, I would say. Just to bring to your notice, in bathroom space, we almost own 60% market share in India. And yes, the founders and the management believes that water and electricity are the two critical part for the home. And we are create products that channelize that. So that's the whole core of the business, though the business dynamics is completely different. Yes, end consumer is same. But coming back to today's discussion, and I think I can really cite one of this a kind of a case study for all of you know, guys, that we have about the business which we do in bathroom business, trade, we have 10% of network, thus 65% of business. So my trade channel partners are there from three generations. So if I can take one aspect of the brand advocacy, you know, it's not only just with end customers, but the whole ecosystem has to resonate the same. True. So it's very, very important that, you know, in all our researches, though FMCG has by the volume of advertising consumption, because bathroom and lighting is a very niche category, is only when you need it, then you recall the category. In spite of that, it's been a super brand from last six terms and is in the top, say, 50 brands in the recall for the, you know, is just because, and all is trusted. So all our research comes that you're the most trusted bath brand. And we went going deeper that what really say these, why these guys say you would trust them, is that the kind of service we provide, which is customer care. So, you know, one example is like, you know, plumbers in India, you know, is not a trained profession. We know we don't, there's no finishing school for plumbers. The way in West, there are proper, you know, the courses for professionals in there. India is like by hit and trial, you become a plumber. And what, and the havoc they create in your bathroom space is that for everybody to have experienced that. We train plumbers, wherein majority people bribe them, is all training session ends with a booze and some 100 or 200 rupees note. From last 60 years, we only train plumbers. And we give them tools. We enhance, we create value for them. And when he knows that he can now earn not only 500 rupees a day, because of training, he'll get 800 rupees a day or 1,000 rupees a day, the dynamics changes. And this is one thing which we have done, which is first of its kind, that today you have 10 types of products in bathroom. So like your shower, your shower enclosures, your whirlpools, your taps. You have 20 plumbers doing that job because there aren't a plumber available who does all. So we are creating a pool of plumbers, which is a complete bathroom solutions plumber. So when you do such things, you know, then definitely whether it's a trader who's doing your business or whether plumbers who's executing, because last mile execution is very important in the B2B categories, wherein brand has a certain level of influence. The people will keep coming to a store and say, I want Jaquar. But the dealer, the plumber can change the game there. So if you ensure that, you know, you have foolproof the system, yeah, then definitely, and this is the whole trust factor of Jaquar definitely is transcending into lighting also as an end customer level. The channel partners, a lot of, you know, the business dynamics so different between bathroom and lighting. A 50% bathroom network channel partners are saying we are willing to come and invest and becoming a lighting dealer for you. Because I know when Jaquar does something, it ought to be good. So this is where you create brand advocates, and this is how been the journey so far.
I think very important point about how the channel becomes very critical, and they are also very large advocates for products and brands that we work with. Soumya, you've worked across brands, and you've seen brands, you've researched on brands, and do you see any kind of formula here? And I know I keep on asking this question, but I guess that's why we're here.
Yeah. So let me just strike a slightly contrarian note. So, I mean, there's a lot of passion in brand building, which obviously all marketers bring to the table. But at the end of the day, the consumer doesn't really get up thinking that I'm going to love a brand. It's just too many other things he or she has in her life, right? You don't even get relationships right, so brand is a lot more distant. But there are some brands that tend to get it right. And in my experience, how I see those brands versus other brands is, there are brands where you know, we talk to consumers and they really have to force them to think about the brand, you know, figure out the brand as their uncle, aunt, brother, sister, and end of the day, you get nothing. And we are told that you're meeting the wrong consumers. And then there are some brands where consumers naturally self-express. When they are not available, they actually feel the loss. I mean, in recent past, you talk about a brand like Maggie, when it was, even when it went through the trust deficit that it went through, even at that time, it did have very strong advocates. some of these brands, and I will also quote a brand like Horlicks or brands like Thumbs Up, some of these brands, if there's no secret formula, but in some way they become, they either own a ritual or a moment of truth, and they become such an integral part of your life that when they are not there, you miss them. And that is where the true, Tata tea, that is where the true, you know, the true test of whether a brand is able to evoke emotion or not. So I think there's no secret formula, but missing a brand when it's not there.
So what you say, I think very interesting point that you said. What you're saying is that a large part of building the brand and having advocates for the brand is to get more and more consumers to use or consume your brand or product as often as possible, and in a manner where it allows them to build a relationship, in a manner where if that product or brand didn't exist, probably I will really miss it, like you say, right? Very interesting. So clearly, then we're going around to a very different, you're laughing. But, you know, thanks, Soumya. Very interesting point. And we'll surely come back to that. Mayank, you know, iconic brand, Parle Ji, you know, it's almost synonymous with the category itself. But I'm curious, what got you to actually want to do a campaign like Naam To Suna Hi Hoga?
So firstly, Naam To Suna Hi Hoga was not so much about Parle Ji. As much as
about Parle,
probably, yeah, the corporate brand Parle. Yeah. The rationale behind doing that was, while you know people knew about Parle Ji and Parle as a corporate which, you know, markets Parle Ji, very few people knew about the other brands that we have. We have 50 plus, you know, brands, and quite a few of them really very iconic, be it probably a hide and seek or a crackjack or a Monaco. But people were not able to relate those brands back with Parle. I mean, that was the challenge. And that was the reason why we came up with... So it was not so much about a Parle Ji kind of a brand as much as about a corporate brand Parle. And ideally, you know, in case of consumers not being able to tie it back to the mother brand or corporate brand Parle, the issue was probably somewhere they were not able to, you know, understand how big or how great, you know, the brand, corporate brand Parle is. So to put it, I mean, you know, as it said, I mean, you know, it's the sum of parts is always greater than, you know, I mean, the whole is always greater than the sum of parts. And that's what, you know, we intended to do when we did Naam To Suna Hi Hoga. So it was more from a point of view of corporate brand where we were trying to, you know, make consumers relate those iconic brands back to the mother brand or corporate brand Parle. While they loved those, you know, brands individually, we've always been, you know, advertising those brands as, you know, completely independent brand, not with the corporate parentage or anything like that. And that's how people knew it. But somewhere the need was felt that, you know, we need to relate them back to the corporate brand, so as to give the corporate brand its due. And that was one of the reasons.
Did you see kind of rub off? Because Parle itself as a brand, like the campaign itself said, is a very strong brand. We all know about it. We all experienced it. We all consume it. But there are multiple products within and brands within the fold. So when you did this campaign, did some of that kind of rub off into the other categories and the other brands as well?
Yeah, it did. So in fact, you know, we saw, as in, you know, right from your brand tracks to many other, you know, research that we did, that people started not only relating, you know, back, but, you know, there were, and if I have to really quote some of the qualitative, you know, responses ad verbatim, well, like, we never knew about so many brands coming from Parle. You know, I mean, for us, Parle was all about Parle Ji, and at most, if they are a little evolved, they would talk about probably a crackjack or a Monaco. Talk about, you know, many other brands that we have, be 2020 or Magix or, you know, hide and seek or Milano and, you know, a lot more. or the entire range of confectionery or even snacking, you know, brands that we have, very few people knew about those brands.
And in terms of specific topology, obviously the market and the competitive environment has changed dramatically, and but it still continues to be a very strong brand, continues to hold its market share. How has the brand continued to run at the speed it is running, even with all the competition? And what have been the experiences of the loyalists, as we call them, and the advocates? What's been their role in driving this brand?
Oh, huge. So, you know, I mean, I told you in the beginning when we met that, you know, you have two biscuit marketeers on the panel. So you'll find, you know, quite a few views which are similar. And, you know, I would, in fact, you know, agree to quite a few things with Sudhanshu said, wholeheartedly, in fact. So, you know, to begin with what Soumya said. So, you know, there's one school of thought where, as Puneet said, you know, you're very transactional relation with your consumer. Where if you're doing a quantitative research and you do something like a household panel or something like that, you measure loyalty in terms of pichli, you know, 10 bar mein, out of the last 10 buys, how many times have consumer bought your brand? And if you say if he has bought, you know, 7 times, you have 70% loyalty. I mean, that's one way of looking at it quantitatively. From, you know, and very transactional. That's very transactional relation that you have with your consumer. To probably, you know, what Anupam said, that, you know, you promise a particular a value or an attribute, you know, and then you deliver on it. Where I would say, you know, you go a little further and you probably over-deliver and delight them from where probably, you know, typically advocacy starts. And they'll start talking about you. So, you know, if you are delivering what you have promised, it's like a transaction. They think that, okay, this is what I paid for. I've got that kind of value. But the moment you over-deliver or deliver more than what you promised is when they get delighted and they start talking about it. To my mind, you know, the acid test for advocacy would be how many consumers will really, you know, root for your brand when you are in some kind of a crisis. Maggie being an example. But I'm saying, you know, we've seen that the moment, you know, consumers start rooting for your brand and not you is when you will. So in case of Parle ji, I think, you know, it has been huge. In fact, you know, I've said this earlier, you know, quite a few times, but the way consumers are related to probably a brand like Parle ji is that the first processed food, at times even the first solid food given to an infant, is Parle ji measured in milk. It starts, you know, that early. And it's something that's going on since generations. So, you know, the kind of bond they have that with a brand is something different. I mean, you know, they root for the brand. And as I said, you know, it's when your brand transcends that barrier of being an asset on your balance sheet to being probably owned by consumers is when you can really say that, you know, they're advocating your brand or that you have that kind of advocacy. In a case, in case of Parle ji, you know, I mean, that's I would say to an extent which was, you know, at times even unbelievable for us. In quite a few focus group discussions or stuff like that, when we normally talk to them, normally don't reveal, you know, the company you're coming from. So when you're talking to consumers, maybe housewives or mothers and stuff like that, and you talk about your brand, you try to say something negative about the brand. They'll come back, they'll fight with you, and they'll tell you, no, you don't know anything. You tell them, you know, it's good for your kid. What do you know about it? We'll tell you how good it is. That's how you know it comes back. So that's what, to my mind, really is advocacy, where they start rooting for your brand. When the ownership, so while, you know, might be, you know, financially the ownership of that asset is with you, but emotionally it has transcended that barrier and is now probably owned by consumers.
So I think I'm seeing a thread across. One is people need to consume and use the product and the brand. That's the base. But all of us seem to be talking about the fact that the moment the transaction has an emotional connection, the moment I can relate it to something that happens in my life every day or those special moments that happen in my life, the joyful you know, banter that I might have with my kid while making an Oreo shake, those moments allow me to build that relationship with the brand and cherish that relationship. And in some form, some of us might translate ourselves into advocates for the brand. I really love what you said, Mayank. about the fact that when you almost kind of needle the consumers about probably making a negative statement, and they fought back to where consumers fight for us and fight for the brands. And what Soumya spoke about Maggie was also very true. We all missed Maggie extensively when it went off the shelves, and we really wanted it to be back. You know, we kind of seem to be agreeing too much here. But we all know there's been an extremely contrary view that's been going on for quite some time, for almost 4 or 5 years now, and which says that unless and until, as a marketeer, your role is to get your brand to the maximum number of people out there, which means you get into their physical and emotional space both. The maximum number of consumers that you can get to is how you will create those opportunities to build relationships and thus create potentials for advocacy, which kind of goes against this whole theory of targeting people who buy my product more, which goes against the theory of even segmentation of any form. And Byron Sharp has written a lot about it. I think in multiple forums we've all spoken about it. But when we think about the conversation we've just had, what he says doesn't seem to be wrong, isn't it? Because we all are saying that you need to create an experience for an emotional bond to get created. And more the number of consumers to whom we can take this experience, the brand becomes stronger. So why is there so much of a opposition or a belief that, no, I need to segment, I need to target, I need to look at my products differently? Or is it purely because I have got limited marketing dollars and I need to figure out the best possible way to spend it for the biggest bang for the buck? That's what drives that segmentation? Because if I was a marketer, probably I would want to reach out to everybody, isn't it? Sudhanshu?
So, hello, yeah. I think it's a debate which can go on till cows come home. So, but I think it's not a contradiction. The way I see it, so you know, what laws of growth and Byron Sharp says is that you need to maximize your reach. You know, your goal is penetration. And to get to the penetration, you need to, you know, drive reach. You know, mental availability, physical availability, and reach. The way advocacy, and I'm not going into the segmentation piece, I mean, segmentation, again, it's a question of how much budget you have and how much reach within the segment you want to achieve. I mean, you can, as a biscuit brand, I can go and target full country. You know, everyone eats biscuit, but I will not have a budget to, you know, make any reasonable reach. So I need to make choices there. Within those choices, we need to maximize reach. So that's the broad direction. I think where advocacy and the whole piece around brand love really, I feel, is in sync. You know, in today's context, in a highly connected digital world, I think the dynamics have completely changed. You know, today, if somebody wants to buy, I mean, if you think about it, if you want to buy something, you know, maybe phone, electronics, cosmetics, baby food, milk, what we do is we go online, check for reviews, or maybe reach out to our WhatsApp group. So advocacy as a mean to make choices is becoming more powerful. And I mean, different categories have different, you know, extent of advocacy being, you know, being the driver. From where, you know, we sit as a FMCG company, and where it fits in our thinking with Byron Sharp laws of growth, we see advocacy as a great means to amplify our reach.
Exactly.
On digital, on social media, and so on and forth. So the way we really think, and I'll give you one simple example. Very recently, you know, one of our brand, Bonvita, you know, did this whole, you know, Beyond Marks campaign during the exam season. So, I mean, the intent at the very onset was, I mean, what is the content which we can create, which is rooted in our brand philosophy, but can inspire, you know, this consumer to engage, resonate, and, you know, celebrate and spread. So that's where, you know, it's like, you know, creative these days jokes. You know, the client goes and tells them that yaar kuch banao which can go viral. That has become the new brief. But, you know, that's the reality. You know, that's how we are thinking about it. What content we can create which can be rooted in our brand philosophy, which will resonate with the consumer and will entice them to engage, interact, and share. And you know, this campaign which your brand team did, you know, we promoted on digital. We went in with certain CPM in mind, certain reach. We engaged certain influencers to, you know, start conversation on social media, and then it got onto a fire of its own. You know, we delivered 2x of the reach we were anticipating. Suddenly our CPMs were half, ROIs were up. So I think that's where, you know, we are looking at it and saying it's a way to amplify our reach in the available buck. And it's hence in completely sync with what laws of growth
correct.
Says.
Correct. Sandeep, you know, I'm coming back to you because you have a very unique category amongst all of us here. And very trade driven, very channel driven. The channel actually influences the consumer a lot. And you spoke about how the channel is actually your biggest advocates. What's the relationship that you've seen between, because the channel are your biggest advocates from a consumer decision making perspective, but it also means that the consumer probably has lesser engagement slash, you know, the kind of love and warmth, all that we've been speaking about for a brand probably is challenge, because I have not been a part of the decision making process. Somebody's advocated for me, I've taken the decision and I've moved on. How do you build that kind of advocacy with the end consumer?
Two ways. See, definitely every category has its own dynamics. The kind of engagement, the category of mine, you know, as customer is very, very intense. Because, you know, building a home, having our own home, and it's a very big thing for Indians. And we really go crazy when, you know, at this stage. And the whole process is... it's painful, at the same time you cherish and you enjoy that. I think the whole game in a category which is slightly more complex and has more engineering or technical side to it, you know, you need to help customer buy. You know, my early days of J. Walter, where, you know, I used to work on Pepsi, and they've done major harm by pulling each other, but barring the PET consumption bottle, they have never done anything to increase the consumption. So if you really help people buy, educate them. So, you know, the advertising is all about education in this category. And what unique thing we have done, we have about 22 orientation centers in the country, wherein a customer walks in. Because, you know, I can say there's this forum, like we were shooting with Deepika, and she said, I want a good bathroom, I don't have. So you can see a beautiful bathroom, but how to get it is a challenge. You want to have a whirlpool, but does your plumbing line supports it? Do you have enough flow rate or pressure in the pipelines? So these orientation centers basically educate customers. You walk in there, they'll understand your needs, and they don't sell it. So they're purely education. And the amazing word of mouth is that, you know, I'm coming from a retail background. We have almost 95% consumption. Retail is all about footfall, your ticket size and conversion. So anybody walking into our OCs, they not only convert, they convert big. The guy has no clue that I'm buying a great shower, but I land up buying a water heater from an electrical shop. And that guy has no clue the throughput of my water. And what happens in the shower, the midway in the shower, my hot water is gone and I'm struggling back. So our entire communication, and we do it you'll see us in all channels advertising it. But our main game, which is a game changer, is a lot of education. Educating end customers, educating dealers. We're making a lot of product films. We generate almost 40 lakh footfall on our websites. Now 40 lakh for a category like a bathroom is a crazy. And average people spend about 10 to 12 minutes. So education is the game. And this is where we'll change people from moving to a shower curtain to a shower enclosure. Now a lot of homes you'll see, you have a full shower enclosure where you'll just take a shower in a corner. The same space you can put a washing machine there, or you can put a laundry bag there. Now people have no idea. So if I advertise a beautiful looking girl taking a shower will not cut, you know, cut ice. You have to educate customer. So we make a lot of product films, we go and talk to customers, we are the only company which doesn't have a sales target. Our guys have a meeting targets. So they're supposed to stand at the retail counter and convert customers for the dealer, and a big conversion. So this is where, and then you create a great advocates. Because if you're not adding value to his purchase, you know, all the brands which you're talking, great brand, Parle, Oreo, you know, every great brand has a great mix of product features and great USPs and selling. Eventually, you have to add that extra, which was he was not expecting it, and which goes a long way. So if I help somebody cross the journey of home building and improvement of bathroom in a very delightful way, this guy will go and tell, you know, to 10 people undoubtedly. Every night on the dinner table, we have a debate with my family on iOS versus Android and Apple. And no, they're not willing to listen to Samsung, not willing to Android. So you have, you're such an evangelist and, you know, loyalist and advocates there, and which is purely on emotional, because somewhere you hit a chord with them, and now you're not willing. Like Maggie example you said, you know, we all remember going for a hiking and, off-roading trips and on you having a Maggie there. You know, those memories are holding you back, and you're not willing to take it down that this product is bad. So I think somewhere
interesting point you said for your category as well, that every category, there is a huge emotional engagement that exists with that experience. Building a house is an emotional experience. Remodeling a house is an emotional experience. There's a lot that goes into emotionally in that. But the point is said that it's also, in this category, a puzzle that you can't solve. You don't have answers of how to do it right. You don't have answers for, is this the right thing to do? Or maybe, can I do this at all? Right? And you're saying that what is an emotional decision? The brand is kind of partnering the consumer in that emotional journey by showing them the way of how to do things better and how to take the decisions better. And that's creating advocates for you.
Great advocates, yeah.
Very interesting. Soumya?
Just wanted to take on the question that you had asked, Sudhanshu, on why is there so much debate on what Byron Sharp says. Actually, simply put, he says that you make your product available, which is a fair point. I mean, where the consumer is, you have to make your product available. The second thing, which is where the debate is how important is it for you to get repeat customers, even in, let's say, categories like biscuits, versus, you know, sort of getting more and more new customers. If we turn the problem around and look at trial as not something that happens once in a life, but something that happens in a given moment or among a given cohort, a target group, or at a certain time, then you perpetually have to create trial. Trial itself becomes repeat, in a sense. So I'm going shopping to get, for my child, I pick up Oreo. I'm going shopping to celebrate, I pick up Oreo. And so if you can create mental availability or mental cues which are linked to moments or linked to occasions, you are perpetually creating trial. So if you can make my bathroom purchase, not purchase, remodeling, from let's say once in 5 years to once in 2 years, which is what a lot of auto manufacturers have done, and which is what great advertising does, right? They sort of push you to plant the thought in the head. If we can actually create trial on a continuous basis so that the difference between trial and repeat is no longer a difference, I mean, Byron Sharp and brand love can coexist.
I think very brilliantly said, really nicely said, kind of captures everything that we wanted. We've just got about 2 more minutes, so I'm going to do a quick wrap up with Anurita. This is not obviously the only brand you've worked with. You also worked in the, the personal care space with Philips, and a category again which is huge potential to penetrate, but low penetration at this point in time in terms of consumers adopting a lot of the products. Have advocates, and I know that Philips has used advocates extensively over the years, especially in this category. And how was that? How did you do that? You used to run the business there, right?
It's an interesting contrast that you mentioned, Ashwin. And in fact, you were mentioning iOS and Android, so I worked with Nokia as well. So, you know, it's just that I think every category goes through a certain task at a certain point in time, and there is a Byron Sharp view and there is a brand love view, but large iconic brands like Maggi, brands like Horlicks, you know, somebody was mentioning, it's really about those rituals, those memories, you know, somebody was mentioning the hiking stories, etc. Because to me, therefore, why is it that Baron Sharpe's theory is so controversial? It is about those many number of people who have used your brand, have had a story about your brand, and those many number of people talking to more people about that story. So it seems quite logically simple that you talk to as many people as you can. Yeah, sure, for media efficiencies, you will do some kind of segmentation and targeting, but penetration any day over consumption. So even in personal care, our job at that time was actually very simple, which is you make people feel good, look good, and they feel happy, and that's it. In mobile phones, it is about connecting people. Similarly, you know, at GSK, our purpose is very simple, which is how do you make a difference in a consumer's life? How do you improve someone's life? How do you make him or her live better? It's just as simple as that. That purpose is clear. There are people who are advocating. But here is something that I was also thinking as people were speaking, that today consumers have far more opinions. They have such strong opinions. There is the social media which gives anonymity to anything that you want to say at any point in time, and it's great because you can opinionate. There is a little bit of dissent with celebrities. We hold far more credibility to people like us because we know each other. And therefore, we have higher believability in people like us talking to us about things that we like and we consume. It's more like to like. And therefore, advocacy is not going to disappear in a hurry.
Cool. Puneet?
So, just like to, I mean, I think we've all mentioned about, you know, emotion and brand advocacy being about emotion. And I think what we need to realize is, and the hiking stories and the Oreo shake and all, or the Tata tea, you know, they are part of human memories now. So what you're not remembering is the shake that you gave to your child. What you're remembering is that parent-child bonding that you had, and the brand was part of it. What you're not remembering is just the, you know, the Tata tea product. What you're remembering is the cause that you believed in, and now you are able to be a part of it and make a change. And that's what emotion is. Emotion is so fundamental, you know, rooted to us, which is why it is about what you were mentioning about, you know, do we target so many customers and, you know, versus focusing on a few. A, it is part of a strategy. I mean, it is a choice of strategy, but it is about going wide versus going deep. You can't have, you know, it's the equivalent of having 1,000 friends on Facebook, but only having a connection with 50 of them. You can keep on increasing numbers, but the real experiences, you know, start happening on a one-to-one deeper level, you know, from a one person. And that is why brand advocacy is very important, because it gives you that multiplier effect. If you form that bond with that one person goes and forms that bond, you know, and stands with you, as we were talking about the Maggie example or any other, whether it's a crisis situation, you know, they are the ones who are sort of advocating for the brand. So that's why I think the brand, what is very under-leveraged, or what the power of brand advocacy that I think we need to leverage is really the power of the multiplier, that you form that emotion, take your time, and that takes time. You can't form a relationship, you know, which is why a lot of iconic brands have stood the test of time, because they've also formed those relationships over time. So it's not a short-term strategy, but it needs to be done very, very mindfully and with authenticity. And the rest of the strategy continues to be there. That's it.
Thank you so much. And I'm going to quickly wrap this up. Some points that came up clearly to start with, what you promise you deliver, that's the hygiene. On top of that, you're able to create those moments, and I'm going to borrow Soumya's you know, words, where you create those opportunities for consumers to try out, create those trials constantly, which also build an emotional connect with your brand, and the way you use the brand ends up creating probably loyal customers. We all agree that loyal customers would, and advocates will end up adding the multiplier. We all want, we all would love to reach out to everybody out there, and probably the advocates will allow us to reach out to more and more consumers much beyond what we can spend on media probably, right? So with that, thank you so much, everybody. Thank you for making this time. And I hope it was interesting enough for each of you out there. Thank you so much.